we talk about history, it doesn't talk about people's history outside of the dominant culture. When you go downtown and you stand in front of the Coleman A. Young building and you see that thing, that statue out there called the Spirit of Detroit, but its likeness does not represent the people that are living here.
I think just being where I'm from and where I grew up, it just feels, I guess you could say, feels like home, yeah. Feels familiar, feels like a vibe that I'm used to. And there's a certain attitude, which is, I guess you could say, grassroots, certain attitude, communal and more communal and don't take things for granted.
As a result of all the hardship and crisis that the city and its residents are faced with, that there's so many points in time where I feel like community comes together and really creates wealth and resilience and resources where people don't think they exist.
I love the resilience of the people, that we have the ability to bounce back from any kind of situation and really make a way out of no way and keep pushing. So in many ways, I think Detroit is like a furnace. And if you can survive in Detroit, it makes you into this hard substance that can survive anywhere in the world.
Well, I love my experience in terms of being aware of the city as a whole. I grew up mainly in Southwest Detroit, but we were very adventuresome, and one of our recreational activities was to take the bus and ride around the city. And so I have been, and one of those rare people who have an East Side and a West Side knowledge. And I love knowing the detail of the city, being able to go to places that other people may not have explored.
I actually love living in a black majority city, and in terms of what that means. These days it means being assaulted politically and economically. And I think Detroit is a, and not just labor, but it really is a movement town. You know, you think of really key freedom struggle events happening here, like Malcolm's message to the grassroots or Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech. You know, to have both of those be first in Detroit is, I mean, that's Detroit right there, or the Big March, or it's a movement city, and for that reason has a lot of resilience and vitality and life even under attack.
We shall not be moved.
Defining my neighborhood, I would define it as a third world neighborhood. As many urban communities across the country are third world neighborhoods, but within those conditions, you have hope. You have people who have a desire to be loved, to love others, to experience peace, to be hopeful, to raise their kids to be great.
People will take the time to engage with each other more so than I have experienced visiting other cities and having lived out east. If you say hi to someone, chances are they will say hi back to you, and I think that acknowledgement of someone else's presence is very important in building community in a city. So that's the thing that I love the most.
I love the tenacity of the people that are here, the courage to stick it out and to work towards a better future. In my community, the diversity of my community, the people, I think, is what I love more than anything else, is from the young kids to the elders, all the different people that I have met and have been blessed to have as part of my life over the years really is, I think, mm-hmm. that I love the most about this city.
A certain glamour.
Growing up during segregation, so growing up in the segregated North, that was an experience. It was a situation where we were forced to kind of live together. So you had people from different incomes, teachers, professionals, and very poor people all in the same neighborhood.
We had everything you needed in the community, from a poetry store. You had the liquor store, the cleaners, the beauty shop, the doctor, the butcher. You had the pawn shop, the laundromat. You had clothing stores, you had furniture stores, right in your community. And that began to change when they decided that they wanted to take the land.
In this neighborhood back in the 70s, it was a neighborhood that had everything you can imagine. I say as a teacher, with the exception of a library. You name it, and it was here. Jefferson had every resource, from Secretary of State to places to clothing stores, places to shop. There was not one empty building on Jefferson, which is one of the reasons that we were, looked forward to moving here, because of the proximity to shopping and getting our needs met.
But before, I remember we had a black-owned pharmacy. Barfwell's there, I used to go there and get my comic books. Mm-hmm. We had a barbershop, Stones, it was long shaker. We had a series of businesses there. The one thing that has changed is the lack of business and investment in that community.
One time we had all kinds of black theatrical groups or community theatrical groups. And we still have a lot now. I still enjoy, have a great time with the young spoken word as well as the old spoken word. I still get into it. The pride, your leaders ranging from C.L. Franklin, Conyers. I still remember at 12 years old, I would play concerts, Sunday teas for Conyers. I would play the piano, my play brother would sing, and this is the way that we would spend our Sunday afternoon.
And the thing that I remember most coming up through there is how full the neighborhood was, how there were houses on every lot, how there were corner stores, mom and pop stores, if you would, how a train ran right down the track over there, you know, that went across the boulevard, and there were warehouses there that they brought goods.
In 1915, when Ford was just beginning to recruit for his $5 a day industrial production, and they would literally go down to the U.S.-Mexico border and recruit to bring people back up. Well, what they didn't say was that, you know, there weren't jobs for Mexicans in the factories when they got up here. So a lot of people were struggling to maintain in the industrial city, but at the same time, building really strong communities and helping to bring more people up. And over the 20th century, many, many families have come up from Mexico.
We couldn't go to the white library. Our library was a very small library that was situated in the black hospital.
That is one of the beautiful things about Detroit, which I think we both may miss. We were known for our houses. I don't care if you rented, whatever you did, you kept your outside up, you swept the dirt. We had beautiful, beautiful homes, beautiful basements, mm-hmm. beautiful parties, places that you could go in and just exchange information. That is gone.
You used to know your neighbor. You used to know who lived next door to you, across the street, around the corner. But now people don't, they don't have that camaraderie.
You don't have no fire station. You don't mm-hmm. have no police station. How does the economy allow a live community like this die?
When I first came to Detroit, I think Detroit had the highest home ownership percentage in the country. We were a community of block clubs. I think at one time there were 300 and some plus block clubs across the city. And yeah, a lot of that was about, you know, getting my sidewalk fixed and beautification, but it was also a way that people felt connected to their neighborhoods and their communities and felt power around that.
The landscape of Detroit has changed quite a bit since the 1950s. In the 1950s, Detroit had close to 2 million people, 1.85 million people. I think of the last census, we might have had 714,000, or just shy of that. Between 2000 and 2010, Detroit's lost a quarter of a million people, and we average about 20,000 people leaving each year.
What happened?
Discriminatory housing and lending practices that forced people of color to have limited housing options in the city and outside of the city. Talk about urban renewal, the use of eminent domain. A lot of those practices that were instituted here in Detroit that created ghettos, both racial and ethnic ghettos in and around the city.
This is the site of the original soup kitchen. This is where it started. And so this is an area that at one time had a lot of industry.
Growing your own food, making your own food, making your own clothes, being able to repair your own home. People should be specialized in what they do, but understanding how it contributes to the whole. And none is at the expense of someone else. It's a delicate balance that I'm talking about, but that's how ecosystems are.
Southwest Detroit is such a unique place in the Detroit metropolitan area because our communities are so solid and so helpful. While black clubs haven't traditionally been a mechanism by which the Latino community have coalesced around food, Dia de los Muertos, where you see lots of activities going on, Cinco de Mayo, where people come together to demonstrate the baile folklorico or the different traditions that have brought people together. And that is the glue that has held our community together during these celebrations. It's both a marker of the hard economic times that we endure.
The gardens are conversation pieces. I find that anytime I have gotten out of my car,
to go and talk to anybody that's in a garden. I am never met with resistance. They always welcome conversation with open arms. I've never met anybody that's like, well, you know, not, you know, kind of standoffish or whatever. They're like always, oh, come on in. It's nice to know people. Gardens provide relationships.
When you talk about, you know, food security, you can't talk about that in the bubble because so many other things affect it. You can't have food security if you don't have water security. You can't have food security if you don't have land security. So those two things go hand in hand. You know, you see a lot of land grabbing, you see water grabbing, you see democracy of the people, the voice of the people being marginalized. So that all goes hand in hand.
Who's that guy? You say, I don't know, but whoever done it, that's remarkable talent.
Creators like Henry Ford put our city on the map by imagining a better tomorrow and then making it happen through entrepreneurial fire.
It has been the media's frame on the message, and I think we have just got to interrupt that.
A lot of it writes off Detroit as a lost cause.
You know, there weren't jobs for Mexicans in the factories when they got up here.
Chapter 2, also known as the Dark Ages, came next. We left our entrepreneurial roots and shifted to a mindset of entitlement. Our arrogance and hubris changed us from creators to protecting hoarders.
Basically saying, like, the people in Detroit can't really do anything about the problem, so we need to import and bring in a set of people who are maybe college educated, maybe whiter, maybe more affluent.
Chapter 3 brings the emergence of Detroit Venture Partners. By investing in early stage technology startups, we plan to help rebuild Detroit through entrepreneurship.
People can go and experience this regenerative Detroit, this new birth, and not ever experience the Detroit that most people experience on a day-to-day basis, you know? I mean, how many of these folks get on the bus and ride for 45 minutes to get out to the northeast side?
Quit believing everything that comes on the TV and radio, and we need to start doing some homework for ourselves. Right size in a corporate model. People get pushed out, can't afford a condo. Choppers move it out, but the rhythm is staccato. Live bases for ancestors pour a bottle.
When we talk about history, it doesn't talk about people's history outside of the dominant culture. When you go downtown and you stand in front of the Coleman A. Young building and you see that thing, that statue out there called the Spirit of Detroit, but its likeness does not represent the people that are living here. And in that aspect, you know, it marginalizes a lot of people and their stories.
There's not one store that did not contribute to the Detroit branch of the Black Panther Party's survival programs.
I love how I was trained by Black professionals here in Detroit. When I came here, I was young. I was 22 years old. It was my first professional job. And the folks I worked for, by and large, were African Americans who were very well trained, highly educated. Many of them had grown up here in Detroit. They had a love for Detroit, and they inspired me to do my best work.
I came to Detroit for a convention that they had, and I fell in love with the city, in part because Coleman Young, John Conyers, Charles Diggs, Irma Henderson, all gave the keys of the city to Angela Davis. This had been a person that was reviled, and to be in a city that could say, this is a person who's standing for the best in America, was amazing to me. Yeah. And I thought, oh man, something is really happening in this city, and I wanted to be a part of it.
But this metropolis is the corporation's thing. It's their thing. They run the politics, the economics, everything.
So for almost the entire time that Coleman Young was mayor, there were no investments in the city. And that was by consent among these power brokers, the banks.
The shrinking of the auto industry, the capital flight first to the south and then Mexico and then beyond, all of that, which was all aided and abetted by government policies, took so much of the resources out of this city.
So when the white flight happened, now what has shaped in the Detroiter mind, or black Detroiter's mind, that white people will one day come back and take the city. It creates this conflict. You know, like you look at Midtown, you look at Corktown, and that fuels them. You know, how the hell you they get support, we don't. How do they get resources and we don't? And again, you know, as a white person, you know, that's the difference. You know, when you understand racism, that white skin privilege automatically puts you at the table, automatically puts you in the conversation to get the resources.
The kind of vision that I think Coleman Young had, some of his work has been undone, but some of his work has sustained us, that we wouldn't be where we are now. We probably could be truly down the chute if it wasn't for some of the things that he had a vision about and put in place.
You see things that are dilapidated and neglected. I think that plays on our community psyche.
I think as African American leaders, we've sort of, the term that we use, we've forgotten where we come from. Mm-hmm. So many of our leaders have sort of given away that power to.
I think what we see in Detroit is some profound levels of benign and even malicious neglect by those with power. And if you really wanted to affirm a community, you would see them one as assets to be invested in and to be strengthened. You cannot see people as a detriment. You cannot see people as those people, other people, poor people. Because the question is, particularly from undoing racism training, why are people poor? Mm-hmm. That's the question mm-hmm. we need to ask ourselves, why are people poor?
It's no accident that the cities that have been targeted for takeover by emergency managers are majority African American cities, and that the forces behind kind of these takeovers of the city are predominantly white forces. So there's been feeling really in Detroit for the last 40 years or so that white people as a group, and I'm using that kind of generic term now, were coming back to take Detroit back over. And so, I mean, that's been the narrative in black communities for years and years and years. And not among academics, but among just the people on the street.
It's an emergency, yeah. It's an emergency, motherfucker.
I've been getting ready to dawn. They tell me that it's get down or lay down or stand up and speak out, cause we know that they found some new shit to play around with. I don't want no king. Rats digging in debt and try to manage it like it's their time. Quit joking, it's D-Town. We found these grounds while they were floating in the wrong way, trying to figure out where in the hell they were going. Anyway, that's for another track. It's an emergency, so I'll immerse to that. So turn the beat up like a thermostat while I disturb the track. Murder that. Quit playing like y'all ain't heard, we'll see. They trying to rob us clean when they should serve us green. It's an emergency,
motherfucker.
Essentially is this narrative, which is very race-laden, that says Detroit has gone to hell because it elected a black mayor, it's a majority black city, it's therefore incompetent, incapable, and corrupt. And so they've squandered all their money, and now they think the state's going to bail them out. No way, we're going to take them over.
I'm opposed to the consent decree, opposed to an emergency manager, and I voice my opinion and my frustration with that. But more importantly, the folks that we have elected to office, such as our mayor and our city council, are responsible to follow the mandate of the jobs and the positions that they have been put in. And I just call tech on them, that you have to make sure you're focused on your job and do it, and then nobody can come in to do it.
Our rights are being taken away from us when things that we voted for, or things that people are supposed to be able to go to the polls and leaders, or collective bargaining, or, you know, all that we've put out can be taken away from us just because somebody else comes in and decides that that's not a good thing.
Part of the narrative here is that in the city of Detroit is that government is broken, and in many ways government is not working for its citizens. But what we don't want to do is we don't want to abandon government, because that creates a huge vacuum. And what we do is we leave resources and the opportunity for power there for the taking. And right now it looks like who's stepping into that vacuum is big business and corporations, who are having a significant say over how we rethink Detroit, how we plan for Detroit, and in many ways have usurped the role, the traditional role of government, in very in ways that are not as transparent, which means that citizens are pushed to the edge.
Of course, I understand that there's a hidden hand, because Detroit is on very valuable property. We're situated in a very strategic location by a major waterway. And I know that there's more to it than our elected officials not being competent, because many of them are.
Didn't just happen yesterday or last week. This happened over a period of 40 years. We're talking about a whole generation.
Mm-hmm.
People stealing, people looking the other way, people not being accountable.
Mm-hmm.
And now you have to be held accountable when people don't like change.
After the signing of NAFTA in 1994, we saw a whole lot of new folks coming up from not only from Mexico, but also Central America. In large part, that was because of the destabilization during the Reagan era. So, you know, we had liberalization of trade over the U.S., Mexico, and Canadian borders. So as a northern border city, you know, U.S. companies were buying land and liberalizing the food markets in Mexico. That created an economy where Mexicans couldn't make their own money anymore. So a lot of folks came up here, and it was a home that for 100 years, basically, we've been helping to stabilize a landing place for the Mexican community in Southwest Detroit and other Latin American countries. Puerto Ricans, Colombians, Salvadorians are here now, and it's a very desirable neighborhood because of the stability and the resilience of our community in helping to support one another in very, very tumultuous economic times.
We're a border city. We're on the busiest northern border crossing in the country. So we have Border Patrol that's patrolling all the time. So a lot of the immigrant community that moved here that was helping the neighborhood to thrive has been moving away.
Since September 11th, I've noticed more ICE patrol cars, more Homeland Security cars driving through the neighborhood. And I think that really scares people from wanting to be here.
Devastating cuts in basic services in our community, and this notion of austerity, you know, that the city no longer has the funds to meet its basic obligation to citizens. A lot of those austerity measures are being driven by government, and so how can we sort of step back and create a response to that? I'm not sure that I have the answer, but I think that's one of those visionary pieces that we need to be thinking and talking about in our day-to-day work.
Pensions are gone, and retirements are gone, and people that save forever in Social Security and 401ks, they have nothing. And they were thought these were golden years. What kind of golden years? And people are having to work until they just drop dead and you put them in a box.
The corruption of politics by the
corporation is not new, it's just getting more extreme.
This has been probably one of the most emotional times in my lifetime. And mind you, I've lived through segregation, assassinations, riots, but it's what's going on here in the city of Detroit now, right now, that I think is probably worse than anything.
3,500.
The superiority belief that your way is the only way, and that's what causes us to intentionally work to destroy other communities and other people, be they different culture, color, age, whatever. It's this, you know, another piece of the meta-narrative that tells us our way is the right way, and it's not okay to have a bunch of right ways. It's got to be our way.
You go walk through any neighborhood in the city, and how could you say that the people in power care about the people in this neighborhood when the city of Detroit can put Christmas lights on their trees downtown but not pay for street lights out in the neighborhoods? Like, how messed up is that? Any form of caring that they have is in the form of like statistics and numbers, and not at all in a community-based conversational relationship level. It's all about their money.
The way that the cancers of greed and war, the way that these viruses, these diseases have spread.
Even in terms of the policies that allow food product to be sold as food when it's has a trace of food, and the rest is chemicals. And then we have health care costs because people are sick, because they aren't eating real food. So they're buying pharmaceuticals, and we're supporting pharmaceuticals. So it's a vicious cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And when we look at it, the baseline again is, where's our brotherly love? Where's our compassion? Where's our humanity?
All we need to do is look at that structure and reimagine it and think of it differently. And how do shareholders move a company not to provide more dividends to them financially, financial dividends, but more social dividends and cultural dividends?
People have plans for these neighborhoods, you know, such as right here in my neighborhood. You have Henry Ford, who's on the further end of the neighborhood. They're buying up all the property, and where they're about to try to create this gated community. And I don't have a problem with buying up the property. I don't have a problem with developing it, but also develop with the people that's already here. Don't force us out.
They're doing that now. Move people out, tear houses down, and collect the land. On the other side, they're renovating these beautiful mansions that we have here in Detroit that have been vacant for years. They're coming back to the Boston Edison community, which is another beautiful historic area, and buying up these homes and renovating them and still pushing and squeezing out people that's Detroiters.
The Regional Chamber of Commerce, they have been the driving force behind privatization. They think that as a private concern, they can do things better than the public. So they've been demonizing, scapegoating, castigating the public employees, the public space, public institutions, and say it's inefficient, which is a lie. And like they're not corrupt, like they don't have inefficiencies, like they don't have embezzlement.
I would say to anyone, you know, protect your spirit. Protect your spirit, because you're in the place where spirits get eaten.
It's obvious that corporations and big businesses are having a significant influence over what's happening in our city, and these large anchor nonprofit organizations like the DMC, Henry Ford Health Systems, they are, for all intents and purposes, organized like corporate structures, but yet they still have this nonprofit status. And I think that what has happened is that they are they have a very clear agenda about what they want to see in the city, and they have opportunities to influence government in ways that maybe everyday citizens no longer have that opportunity. It's almost like the shadow government that exists.
Oftentimes people make decisions and think they're making the right decisions, or they have involved or included a certain member of the Latino community who don't even live here or don't even feel the impact of what goes on, policies and so forth in our community. So oftentimes one member that's invited to the table, they feel that that represents the community. That's not the case.
Foundations probably wield more power right now in the decision-making in our city than elected officials in some cases.
I don't think it's that all foundations are bad, you know? I don't think all foundations are good either. I think that we all inhabit this gray area. But I do think that one of the things you find too is that communities feel powerless to those that have money. And communities are doing the work of those foundations. Mm-hmm. And those foundations can do nothing. Foundations, ultimately, all they can do is dish out money and report on what they dished out money for. And that's not bad. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, who does the work are those on the ground. And I really think that it's time for the foundations, and some do, but it's time for the foundations to recognize that, you know, this should be a very equal relationship, considering what you're getting out of the deal.
Very often the foundations tend to want to support the larger organizations. But the larger organizations sometimes have grown away from their mission and away from the people. That doesn't say they don't get work done, but they're not on the ground getting the work done.
Until we get some changes in the way we learn, in the way we are taught, I think we're gonna be stuck where we are.
I mean, you snatch jobs. You snatch schools from kids. You know, so no kid that can go to a walk to school, I mean, literally just walk right here now. They got to go to a whole other neighborhood. And again, when you look at the infrastructure, these two neighborhoods are at war with each other. Two, three generations deep. Now you expecting this kid to go over in this community where he has no relationship to? And again, and those are problems that we need to be dealing with, but that's the best practice. So now it's on the ground, you're making it more harder. You're intensifying the situation.
I've never seen such repression and such raw racism, where you can create a separate school district for the failing 5%. I'm just simply a person that lives here on the ground and observes it. But it looks to me like the tentacles have gone out so far and they're reaching inward now. Mm. It's like a disease of greed that eventually eats itself. Mm-hmm. And so the most vulnerable people are going to be the ones. They figure out how to make money off of poverty.
Maybe this crisis around governance is an opportunity for us to say, well, what if we create a new governance? And if we make that part of our work, that's going to require us to work together in a different way.
Hope is really crucial, you know, and being able to imagine something different.
I think one of the most profound things I've ever heard was when Grace Box said, we are the leaders that we are looking for. And I think that is so powerful. And also, she said that we are not ghosts. So we all have a voice, and we all have something to contribute.
I must start thinking, it's so bad in Detroit, we can just move, because what we are learning today is that even if we move, it's going to catch up at some point. So I think it's a good point for us to really think about. So how do we provide more democratic way of thinking and doing the things that we do.
Rather than looking at what you have right in front of you. And that's the people in the residence right here in the city of Detroit. Again, I'm talking about the genius at the bottom. Most of us totally ignore it. We dismiss it because it's not up here and it's not shiny and it doesn't have a PhD, it doesn't have a master's, it doesn't have these things, but it has all the creative senses and the innovation that anyone else has. And so it's totally ignored.
I think we need to unite around, most fundamentally, having a voice and determining the fate of our own community, and demanding that the state and the country help us to recover, because it's not charity, it's payback.
I don't think we really see the beauty in ourselves, because we don't see that resiliency that in the face of all odds, having a job or not having a job, in the face of this racialized region, it's like we still here, and some of us are even thriving, but I think the majority of us are in survival mode.
Majority of us in the city
are in survival mode. We're paycheck to paycheck, hand to mouth. We rob Peter to pay Paul, you know, all the the chatter. And it builds a sense of anxiety, high blood pressure, frustration, and still we move through.
You know, it's a shame to me having all these vacant homes in the community, and we have so many people that are living on the street.
Yeah.
And so I think it's part of our responsibility as community members to take care of our fellow human beings that live around here.
The fact that after 08 you had so many foreclosures and so many vacant houses that are just going to waste, I think that we had a comprehensive plan to actually renovate houses versus tearing them down. You can make a very different city. The city would have a very different tone. And complexion, not necessarily skin color, but an attitude towards the city.
So, you know, well, on the one hand, I understand the importance of having mixed income and people with more resources to be able to build up the tax base and to develop the community. I still think that we are not paying enough attention to securing the homes for the people who already live here.
One of the things that really hurts people here, in kind of the metaphorical way, that's really great, is that a lot of people have either never been given the chance or forgotten how to hope. And I think that's one of the really, really big things that keeps people from being able to create a world that they believe is possible.
Bring people together.
The building of consciousness deals with vision and work. So the work that we want to do creates a sustainability for our lives and our family. And that's what this revolution is all about. It's about how do we survive as human beings? How do we reconnect ourselves with objective reality without being marginalized?
Make some noise. This is dedicated to all of the Detroit ballers.
I'm from the city.
I envision a Detroit. I envision a Detroit of producers and consumers being the same thing. So one of the things we think about is that work with the new technologies that have kind of unemployed us are now the new technologies that we can employ to begin to kind of create a much more craftsman-like existence, where we are not just consumers of things produced in China, but we can actually produce the things we want, our own clothing, our own furniture, our own food.
So I'm thinking that my vision from Detroit is that there would be the restoration of the participation of everyday people, and that everyday people feel valued. They feel that their voice counts, that their needs are of concern of the larger community, and that there is hope for our collective survival.
vision for Detroit would be that we build an infrastructure to support 21st century organizing. And that means paying attention to leadership development at the community level. We may not have those traditional structures anymore, but people still live in neighborhoods and communities, and they live and they want to have a quality of life, and they want to have their issues tended to by their government.
Well, wouldn't it be cool if we were the ones doing all that and creating that economy and taking hold of that and making the decisions and being the leaders and owning those spaces, not all these other companies that are going to then control us, create these things for us, tell us what to do and how to do it.
You have a lot of different people coming together with their own causes coming to make changes. So that just demonstrates that people is tired. People are saying that something needs to be done. It's no longer talking and talking. Mm-hmm. It's about action. It's about change. It's about, well, it's okay to sit on the outside and say what should be done, but at this point you have people willing to stand up.
There's a lot of movements going on that are all over the place. There's welfare rights, of course, doing the important work of fighting the foreclosures and putting people back into homes and fighting the utility shutoffs. Mm-hmm. People's Movement Assembly that came out of the social forum.
Right.
The groups that still meet.
Mm-hmm.
There's lots of organizations. And then here in the Latino community.
The work that we're conducting is to sustain us and not somebody else, as we've been doing, like when you go to work at a plant that I call work camps. But this metropolis is the corporation's thing. It's what we want to do today is create an autonomy that we can control, that will serve us. We want to create an apparatus, a community apparatus that will serve us.
We have a lot of talented people in this community, but you'll never know them because you walk by them every day. The singer Kemp,
mm-hmm.
He was once homeless.
Mm-hmm.
He was once part of the NSO.
Mm-hmm.
When he says the song about Mack and Third, he was really there. He was really in that community.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's a recording
mm-hmm.
artist.
Mm-hmm.
But you have a lot of talent like that in this city. And it's a untapped resource. You have unemployed teachers, unemployed masonry, you know, in all walks of life. You have all of this talent here, and nobody's using it. I mean, it's kind of like they're tossed away of the community, but everybody isn't a derelict, or, you know, they just come into some unfortunate mm-hmm. time in their mm-hmm. life.
I have a voice, it's very loud, wasn't my choice. So many people everywhere have no voice, only despair. So I chant the chants of the change to come. I raise my voice for those who have none. So into the streets, now we must go. It's time to stand up and just say no.
And if nothing else, we have the power to disrupt and derail. And so we always have to keep that in mind, that we're not just victims, that we, you know, we can and we should and we will define our own reality. So that's the type of power as well.
I believe in doing researches. I don't believe we need to make quick decisions. We could research. We can have real discussions as to what other options there are.
Seems like we're getting pushed out, but the community refuse to die. They keep fighting, and they're gonna be heard. The scenes out there meet regularly and always organizing to do some kind of action. Immediately when they talk about closing down the bridge, we go down to City Hall.
I think that we've disproportionately taken too much money out of my neighborhood, which pays some of the highest taxes in the city, commercial and residential, and we've put that money into downtown to try to entice these new Detroiters to come here. And I'm saying, if you love Detroit, you'll pay the taxes. You know, you'll buy the property. You'll have skin in the game if you really love the city and you love its citizens. You don't have to be enticed to be here because you understand the value.
I think the people that are most inspiring as a whole are the people who are willing to enter into the process. Because it takes a lot of courage to say, I want to sit down with or across from somebody who's really harmed me, or I want to sit down with somebody that I've really harmed to share stories and say, we want to change things.
The most potent thing in the districts is the citizens advisory groups. I think their presence, their voice, their agency, their standing is going to make the district political leadership highly relevant to that area. So that's where, that's the sunshine in all of it, is the new charter mandates those boards, those citizens advisory groups, and I love it because that's a level of civic mindedness returning back to us.
I think the work of what was called We Pros, We the People Reclaim Our Streets, this was when crack first came into the neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. We started marching in neighborhoods with neighborhood people against crack houses. We marched every Friday night for about 5 years in these neighborhoods. And what happened was not only did crack houses close down, but crime in general went down. There's a neighborhood right off of Livernois, Pilgrim area.
Mm-hmm.
Crime was reduced in 1 year by 80%. Now, that's an amazing shift.
I'm so committed to this. I'm going to walk up and down this street until you talk to me, until you hear my voice, until you make a change.
Remembering our humanity seems to be a very difficult task. And I think if we understood and, I think that if we took some time to get to know each other a little bit better and to appreciate the people that we work with and know a little bit about their history, that we'd be able to work much better together. And if we were, I also think that we were able to take better care of each other, mm-hmm. or of ourselves, it'd be easier. I think a lot of people are stressed out, are in a lot of pain, and probably have have very serious health issues. Mm-hmm. It makes it very hard for us to remember and recognize the humanity in one another. So that's not a skill, but I do think it would tremendously help in how we're able to work together.
I feel like there is all of these people who want to come and be part of, you know, like people see what is going on here, you know, and really want to participate in it. And so how do we do that in a way that has integrity, you know, and how do people come and help or participate without stepping over the work that has already been going on here and the community that already exists here? And I think part of that conversation is race.
I think that waking people up to their consumer power in terms of how they participate in their own oppression, how the elected officials represent or do not represent their interest, how when they spend money, whether or not those profits return to the community in any way, the consciousness and the need for people to have a different understanding of the economic landscape, the impact of business on their health.
So, you know, along that same line, I would like to change the spirit of accountability in the communities. Be accountable for where you live. Don't just let things happen. Be accountable for where you live.
Keep thinking about a Martin Luther King, a Malcolm X, like movement building, charismatic leadership. But I'm also thinking about leadership development. How do we take the singular leader and make 20 leaders?
How do we figure out how to utilize the
the buildings we have? How do we figure out how to utilize the buses that we have? How do we figure out how to utilize the university? And most of all, how do we figure out how to utilize the people and this wealth of talent, of brain power, of muscle, of know-how?
You know, my daily experiences, all of these incredibly inspiring, incredibly committed people.
In order for us to increase in power, we had to increase in mass, in voice, in support, in the number of young people who were invested in a youth-led movement, in figuring out ways to transform their community.
My hope is for, is in the people. And for us to utilize what it is that we have. You can't just vote for someone and then expect them to do right by you. You have to stay in after them. So my hope is in the people.
Eastern Europe, you know, what happened there in the Arab spring certainly shows that when people mobilize, ordinary people have tremendous power. So I think those are models we can look at least and draw from and be encouraged by. And
because I think ultimately the strength of our movement, and here I will say movement in a much broader sense, depends on the strength of the fabric that we build of relations and how much trust we have in one another.
Research, whatever data comes out, we have to be a part of that, it has to be shared. Whatever implementation is going to happen, we have to be a part of that process.
The idea of you can't build it, you have to prepare for it, I think is right. And
we're like, power is really growing within grassroots communities, and what I see, you know, AMP doing, the Digital Justice Coalition, the Food Justice Task Force, like the, you know, Restorative Justice Initiative, like the Research Justice Initiative, like all of these just different, I mean, there's so many pockets of networked activities emerging, and I think it feels like this almost like alchemic process where people are like figuring out like how do we create our own power.
The Uniting Detroit project started a couple of years ago and kind of grew out of the observations that some of us had made about the need for a better infrastructure to do organizing and progressive work in Detroit. A lot of times people are so focused on their work in this particular side of town, you don't always know what's happening, let's say, on the northwest side or southwest Detroit. So could we sort of create some synergies by sort of learning from all folks what was going on, getting people to sort of talk about the vision that they're holding, the kind of work that they would like to see happen around movement building. Because right now we're in the midst of this huge reworking of Detroit, right-sizing, and, you know, sort of disinvestment from certain neighborhoods, and in many ways citizens are on the outside of that. So start talking about what are the tools that community folks could use in order to be more successful in defining what their own communities could look like, engaging in their own mapping strategies, looking at both the way the community looks and identifying those injustices through spatial analysis, but also saying, and here's what we would like to create in its place, and how that becomes both a movement building tool, organizing tool, advocacy tool, in a way to kind of bring people together in their neighborhoods and contribute to a broader mission. And so that's kind of the way Uniting Detroiters is evolving.
Oh.
respect, life, honor, death. City stitched on the belly. Hey, techie on the chest, he inscribed. Perfectly executed, we Lilliputian. I'm too busy building global media institutions to get caught in confusion. Delusions of grandeur, they say they move in units while we stay back in them vans up. Say they been the building, but we stay architecting plans up. Industry bringing cool millies to my city. Fans up and hands up for God written in stanza. Osari audio 16s, I pick your foes. And for the future, thorough spit it original. Plus, handle my BI and keep a clean, 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 clean.